right. Good evening, everybody. We're just having a robust discussion here before the meeting starts about who's going to go first. So, actually what we're doing tonight, this is a tri-board meeting. School committee couldn't make it, and right now it looks like the finance committee is
not here,
maybe a little late too. I haven't heard from them yet. So our goal tonight is to go through the strengths, weaknesses, and other threats. Is that what
yep.
it is? Yeah, I keep forgetting what it is.
Opportunities.
That's it. Strength, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats analysis. So we got town hall and we have the DPW. So did you guys decide who's going first back there yet?
I'll go first.
Okay.
Thank you, Tim.
Man up.
Man up. I'll even sit up.
Plenty of room.
All right.
I'm gonna find you now.
He's towards the, he's the last one.
The last shall go first.
You want mine up then? That one's done.
That does make it easier now, because now we can work
backwards, yeah.
So I trust that you guys reviewed these things. Mm-hmm. So I think that you'll find that most of our strengths are going to be the same throughout, that we have the same thing. Since it's a very small group of people, we get along very well in the town hall, which was not always the case, but it is certainly now. One of my other strengths is I have a civil engineering degree, and I'm also here, this is my 29th year. So that has, I bring forth a lot of experience to you guys. I've been in the past, been extremely active with code. Through the state. I haven't been in the last few years, but was president of our association, was on the councils for review of all the codes, but I'm letting the younger guys do that now. The weaknesses, most of the issues, is most everything. Lack of money. One of our biggest problems, which is needed in the town hall, is a comprehensive a software and package for all of our data. If we had one system that everything was compatible with, all the information from all the departments, which is very critical, can be put on there by all employees, and then everybody can see it. That's Concom, Planning Board, Fire Department, everybody, anything and everything. Everything goes to a parcel, an address. Let's get it all there so everybody can see. Right now, we're still in the paper mode. I have our department has to physically make copies of multiple permits to get it to the different departments so they know what's going on. It's not the best way of handling all information to all the other departments in this type of technology. I think is one of our biggest problems in here. Luckily, since we are so close-knit, there's a lot of discussion back and forth and asking questions. As one of the things you can see if you go in my back room is I am saturated with paperwork, unfortunately, with way the code reads, national law, I cannot throw out a single piece of paper relative to any building. And now we have massive quantities of paper back there. I'm getting to the point that it is, there's no way I can get much more in there. Another couple years, I think we're gonna have to start relocating some of it if we don't go to an electronic age and having that filed in a different.
Tim, will the state, will it allow for electronic storage? So it could be scanned as long as you have
yes.
the actual image?
That's correct. That's the Hilltowns have gone all electronic with the permitting and for the filing. Mm-hmm. The state is now all. We were hoping that the state would pass on their system, but the Hilltowns system apparently is extremely good, mm-hmm. and it's worked well.
In New Hampshire County or Franklin yeah. County?
Franklin County.
Okay.
They have iPads.
They run everything through Greenfield, most of it, don't they?
All of it goes through Greenfield, that is the co-op system. And everything's by iPads, they can finalize permits and projects out on the field, they can issue permits out on the field, they can do almost anything that they want to. Certainly it is a learning curve, it's gonna take some time to get up there, but it is something certainly we've been talking about for quite some time. I hope that in the very near future, that that can happen, because it certainly will save us some time.
And space.
And a lot of space. One of the other thing is, we keep on getting, even today, we just got something new from the state legislation, another piece of paper that's gotta be filled out by multiple people, and it's just time consuming, it's just getting, I don't even think that they even know the extent of the forms and everything that they're requiring. It's impossible to deal with, it really is. One of the big, major changes, which you know of, is that the fire departments are now very intertwined with our inspections. That has created a lot of problems in this town because of the amount of emergency calls that come out. It's very tough to get through the annual inspections in a timely manner. We do it, but it is a problem. So more gentlemen over there on full time certainly will help throughout this whole process. Opportunities. One of the great things that the state does have is their certification process. And we have to maintain our certification. The nice thing is that we have a lot of educational courses that are free to us. Right now, the big thing right now is energy. We have a lot of catching up. We are one of the progressive states with regard to energy. We are in the 2012 Energy Code, and we will very shortly be in the 2015. Major changes for everybody down the road. The hope is that it'll save 50% of all the energy costs within a building. But that means a lot more education, a lot more types of inspections, and very stringent and strict requirements. The threats, I did say the legislation, I think that's one of our biggest problems as inspectors. They pass these laws on a knee-jerk reaction with regard to something that has happened. Some of them are good, some are bad, but I don't think legislation is a way to write code. We have an international code, the entire country deals with international code. If you need and believe that there's a change, go to that venue and get a change. Simple to do, everybody does it, but I do not think that legislation is the thing. Brings problems for us because it hasn't been thought out. We have a lot of numerous problems associated with it. A lot of definitions that are not defined.
Have you done any, has the association done anything to communicate that to the state?
Yes, we have done that for numerous years. When I was president, I went to the state many times to talk to the commissioner on it. He knows. We went to the legislators. But you have to understand their constituents are pushing them to make change too. But we have now a pretty good system. We just hope that it's used. They're supposed to be reviewed under a new department. Certainly the new governor is pushing for that. That's why we haven't gone into the new building code as of yet, because he wants that entire thing reviewed. He wants it done correctly. He wants input. He wants to know what the hiccups are before it goes into place.
You're optimistic that that'll be done, or have you heard this before?
I'm very optimistic because he has really put the brakes on a lot of the, it's certainly some of the stuff is squeaking through, but like for instance, this piece of paper that came through, I want to find out where it came through. It just creates a bottleneck for everybody in order to close things out. We have permits. This has to do with smoke and CO detectors. They have multiple signature requirements. Why do you have to do that? If you go close it out with a certificate of occupancy, that's stating that everybody's approved it. Why do you have to have another piece of paper? So it's just those things that we have to work out. Certainly on our front, our bylaws in some respects have some tweaking to do. We've had some changes on town floor through some people that for whatever reason really wasn't the best change with regard to the planning board's opinion on it. But we'll never stop that type. But it does, again, it creates a problem sometimes for us.
A lot of the building codes are being adapted along with the NFPA codes also, with the fire codes.
Well, we're one of the very, very few states that use NFPA. Our NFPA codes regulations are embodied within our code through appendices, and that's where you get the particular information. We don't use the NFPA code, we use the ICZ code, and this next code, we are getting rid of the Massachusetts edition of. The only thing that we're going to be changing is two sections that has to do with fire and how we work together, and the other is the administrative section. Other than that, I think we're going to have a ICC compatible code. We've asked for that for a long, long time. This past code, they had over 300 of the 700 pages changed. That's crazy. Why use it?
It's like the plumbing code and the in-town sewer codes that we have. How they need to work together, and they need to be combined in some places to make it a lot easier on us, the inspectors.
Yes. And that's another big thing. When I started back in 88, we had one little book. It was pretty small. It was only about yay big. You know, that was the entire code. Now we have two main codes. They're over 700 pages long. And then we have five or seven individual codes. Mechanical, energy, maintenance, and the like. It's just gotten to be so complex and so nobody knows. Can you know it all? You just can't.
Sorry. I've got two questions.
Go ahead.
Okay. First one, Tim, could you, under weaknesses, you made a comment, said all inspectors should be under one budget. This will allow some flexibility to cover possible unforeseen personnel time. So right now you've got you and your assistant are in your budget, and then we have
correct
gas, plumbing, electrical.
They're under Board of Health. Electrical is directly under town administrator. They're not under the same budget, and we've talked about that at length. It's been 5 or 6 years that we've all discussed it. I think that if you look at most of the towns, they're trying to get most of the inspectors under one roof. We can start off with a budget, can play, that gives us a little bit of flexibility. You know, we have electrical, gas, and plumbing in my office right now. We do the permits, most likely very shortly, probably have to do the fire prevention, sprinklers and stuff to some extent. That's gotten very complicated on how we're supposed to intertwine with that. But actually, even today, Mike and I talked about that. But I think that it would be very, very beneficial to have all permits coming through one department.
One unit.
One unit, yes.
Especially if there's some sharing of information via
correct
database, yeah.
But again, we got to network this stuff. We've got to. It's a difficult task now. Mm-hmm. We've certainly increased the number of permits that are being pushed out of the office.
Then the second question I had was one of the things I didn't see on here that I thought might be on here. So I know we've had some conversation in the past about your ability to, enforcement ability, that that's an area of weakness. And I didn't see it on here, but is that something that you still feel?
Yes, I mean, you're correct, I actually did not put that on, but that is something that we've talked about with regard to the courts and how that is compatible, how it can work better for us.
Mm-hmm.
They changed a lot of the codes in that effect also, right?
Yeah.
And is that anything we can combat as a town via bylaw, or is this...
No, we went to our rep to ask him to look into it a little bit on how the courts can help us. On the other side, the housing court's gotten much, much better for us.
Mm-hmm.
Do I use it enough? No, I just don't have enough time to do all this stuff. I'm at the point now I have to really make constant decisions on what I'm going to do in the day. There's no way I can do all these inspections. I can't. I'm very, very fortunate that there's a lot of really good contractors in this town that do a lot of good stuff in this town. And I can rely on them calling me and telling me where they're at. We discuss it, we get photos, but that's really not the proper way of doing everything.
Mm-hmm.
It's just the way things are. I mean, you had an ISO report that said this town's supposed to have 2.5 inspectors. Is that ever going to happen? I know that's never going to happen, but should we have a lot more hours in? Yeah, of course. I'm using the alternate most of the time now to do all the annual inspections. Actually, that's starting to work well with the fire department. Nick's out there doing a lot of them with Steve. Luckily, we have Steve because he's what we call the roving inspector throughout many towns. I didn't have him right now, I can't get anybody.
Mm-hmm. So there are enforcement things that you're just not able to get to, right?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And in particular areas, like?
But so it's a lot of the I'll call the smaller, but to the neighbors, very critical zoning issues.
Yeah.
You know, we eventually get to, but I'm not prioritizing them on that day or that week. It can go a month. And there is one on West Street. You know, it's been going around and around in emails. Do I have time to go over there right now? No, it's there. It's always going to be there. Is it a safety issue? Is it hurting somebody? No. But is it a new person that did something wrong? Yes.
Mm-hmm.
But it probably didn't realize.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we'll get to it, but we can't get to it now.
Mm-hmm.
We have too many other things that we have to catch up on. The last few weeks was the school. We had to get those things through. There are times that there are specific times that we have to get things done.
Mm-hmm.
But I can't emphasize more that, in my opinion, the most critical thing that creates problems is fire. I'm not saying there's anything bad. Mike is killing himself, but the number of emergencies, I'm with him all the time, and you only have two guys out there doing these emergency calls. He has to go to these things, and it really impacts me.
Right, so if he's responding to an accident, you're left hanging.
That is his main critical focus.
Yeah.
He has to do those. It puts us in a lurch. Then we're very, very flexible. That's why I've had to bring in Steve a lot, getting Nick to do a lot of them.
John?
Chuck?
Okay. Thank you very much.
Saturday, did you want to say something about Saturday? Did anybody get back to you on Saturday?
No, Saturday.
Yeah, there's a
contingent we'll be making.
Right.
Okay.
So how many people are actually going to the building?
I think I'm going to start here and go around.
All right. Thank you.
All right.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
So we'll post that meeting.
Post that
it's
meeting.
Posted.
It's posted.
It's posted. It's posted.
Bridget's posted.
Okay.
Thank you, Bridget.
Is there donuts in this meeting? It's Saturday.
Where are you going to pick them up? Where are you picking them up?
I don't know. I'll have to get donuts, I think. It is a Saturday meeting. I have to make it special somehow.
You're across the street.
All right, let's see.
Backing up.
Oh, we'll let the planning board go next.
Sure.
And thank you for doing it, yes.
Of everything. I think we're the only board that did the full discussion of this on live TV, so. The only thing I want to add to it that I was just thinking about, actually when I was listening to Tim talk about something different, for the 8th legislative session in a row, there are proposals to rewrite the zoning bylaw, or the zoning code for Massachusetts. The code that we have now dates back to about 1978. And it has been edited, it has been amended, some of the amendments are mutually inconsistent. There is a proposal to rewrite it entirely, and it has been introduced in each of the past 4 sessions, 5 sessions. So that's a threat in that it is going to increase the learning curve, trying to figure out what's going on. But in general, I think you'll see that our strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats are basically reciprocals of each other. We have a lot of experience, but that means we have a very concentrated group of people who are doing all of this. And we've done, we adopted the first zoning bylaw in 1962 or 63, I think. And I believe that since then, we, apart from an occasional temp employee, we have not had any staff for the planning board in 40, 50 years. That's going to come to an end at some point. And we don't know exactly what that point is going to be. But the reciprocal to longevity in office is that we've all been around for a long time, and we won't be around for as long going forward. But generally it's working very well. We have people who know what they're doing, and even the new people who are on 2 of our 5 positions have extensive experience with municipal government anyway. So it's not like we have complete newcomers trying to figure out which end is up. Having said that, planning law, zoning law is, it's a real subspecialty. There are lawyers who only do subdivision cases and others who only do zoning violations. And you have a board which is trying to handle all of this without I understand we can figure out something for getting direct website access. We'll work on that. Clerical support, I've been able to share my office capacity with the board, but there's a tipping point there. There's a learning curve. And with respect to what Tim said, and picking up on that, I had put down in the weaknesses what I called uncoordinated permitting. And I know that Tim tries to give us copies. I try to copy him on our decisions. I copy the assessors on our decisions. The Conservation Commission copies us on their agendas and their decisions. So. But that's all on paper and email chains that are floating back and forth. So to the extent that it would be possible to have some sort of a GIS solution that would allow us to look at all aspects of a project, where's the planning board on it, where's the Conservation Commission on it, is the building department involved, what's the tax status, what's the tax revenue that, you know, if we're balancing something, if we approve one project versus another, where's the current tax level and where might it go? So there are a lot of possibilities there, but it is something that we haven't even begun to explore. The opportunities, we are working on an update of the master plan. And one thing that we kicked around in the past that probably is worth stepping up again, at one point we had sort of a development a development team, and it was someone from planning board, someone from building, someone from assessor, someone from conservation. I think we met twice in a 6 month period 10 years ago, and it just didn't get traction. Of course, everybody is pulled in a multitude of directions, but having some sort of a coordinated approach to this, you know, right now someone comes in and they make a stop in town hall and throw out a question about zoning. You know, what's the zoning for this lot? Sometimes they throw it at the town clerk. Sometimes they throw it at the assessors. Sometimes there's not a simple answer. A lot, the Seven Sisters property, the lot is, the parcel is carried as commercial, but it's actually bisected by a zoning line. And the structure sits right on the fault line. So, you know, these are the kind of things that, after the fact, they show up as, oh, yeah, that, maybe we should have spotted that earlier. And the other thing we kicked around a little bit was a permitting guide, just sort of a who, what, when, where, why. To some extent, part of that's taken up by the website. We have more detail than we ever did on the website. So the weaknesses and the threats are two things that, and I think everybody on the board will agree. Jim Maximoski and I do most of the motive work. We keep things running. We do the scheduling, we send out the notices, we send out the decisions, we by and large talk, individual board members will talk to people who have a comment about a particular case, but if somebody wants to contact the planning board, I'm the daytime contact. Jim is willing, works out of town, but he's willing to take calls at home at night. That's all on the website. But the others don't have them. In that much flexibility. So it's worked out. It's working at this point, but you know, where we go from here is uncertain. Lisa Sanderson had been on the board for 10 years. She decided for personal reasons she couldn't do it any longer and stepped down. That year, the election went to a write-in. No one stepped forward to actually take out papers. We see people at our meetings, but they don't come back if the issue is not of direct concern to them. We haven't found anyone out there who's been so interested that, gee, I'd like to get more deeply involved in this. So. You know, we're in a situation like a small business. We're talking about succession planning. I have been on the planning board now for almost 30 years. I'm still third in seniority on a five-member board. There's only so much more that I'm not planning on leaving, but there is a horizon out there that we may have to go to someone in the nature of a town planner. That was a suggestion of the master plan. We avoided that cost bullet by striking an arrangement with the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission to provide backroom services. They help us with drafting bylaws, so we don't have to sit down and work through the grammar ourselves. You know, at some point, to get continuity, we may have to go to another model. We've been very fortunate. gotten 50, 60 years out of this model, but it's not going to be the model for the next 60 years, I'm afraid.
Questions? So, I kind of talked to you a little bit about this. Have you thought about how you would do, how you would like to switch it over, how you'd like to transition, or how you'd like to start something? If you had the ability to say how you want to start transitioning from the model we have now to another model, have you thought about how that
might I work? Think we are going to work that out to some extent through the master planning process, because that is the proper vehicle for talking about some of these things. It's an interesting cycle. We're a planning board, but we're also a permitting board. And so we have been very fortunate from the planning perspective that we've had a slow economy for the last year and a half or 2 years, because that has given us time to do the planning aspect of it. We've adopted new subdivision regulations. We've advanced a lot of bylaw language in a lot of areas. But now we're shifting over into our permitting board, and we're a leading indicator of economic recovery. Actually, the leading indicator is when I start getting calls from architects who are talking about what could be designed for a particular parcel. And actually, Dan, you might be a leading indicator too. You get some land developers who start nosing around at some point.
We'll get people in looking at land, but they don't really want to say what they're doing.
The architects the architects have to come up with a little more detail about whether it's going to be a restaurant or a retail or something like that. And now we're starting to get actual applications in. So we are booking out, we're completely booked for October right now with some substantial projects, plus continuations of some prior ones. So when we're in that permitting cycle, we don't have as much time to work on things like the master plan. We have to fight to preserve some space for that. But yeah, we're trying to work on some of the nuts and bolts, not just the pie in the sky vision of blue skies, green fields, and no traffic. But we also like to talk about how we keep the system working. So that will be part of the master plan this time.
Any other questions?
As far as the zoning laws themselves, I mean, they're mostly mandated by the state and the voters, so.
Probably a good quarter of it is, we've adopted river regulations to conform with the flood insurance. We've adopted drainage regulations to conform with what DEP wants. There is room for some uniquely local-based, and probably two-thirds of it is still local-based. And we had, and some of it's reactive, we had a period where bed and breakfasts were getting under people's skin, so we adopted a bed and breakfast bylaw. We haven't actually permitted a bed and breakfast in probably the last 5 years. We do home occupations periodically, but some things rise and fall as an issue, and then at some point we can perhaps ease them out. But we still have a bylaw. The original bylaw was about the size of a wallet in shape, and about 15 to 20 pages, including a fold-out map. And we're now over 100 pages, and the map takes up half a wall. And it's not, I'm not seeing it go backwards.
And there's so specific for the town of Hadley, there's really, this particular department's not something that you would look at going on a county level?
No. Well, first of all, by statute, you can get maybe support services on a pool
like
level.
Like through Pioneer Valley.
But the actual, oh yes, this is the original zoning bylaw with its map.
That is amazing.
That is.
Although, what is really amazing is, if you look at this map and compare it to our current map, it is virtually the same. We have some overlay districts that are different, but limited, well, actually, Route 47 was full business when this was laid out, and it's now limited business or local business. But the Route 9 commercial corridor is pretty much the same now as it was in 1961. And that has been our master plan, and you know, it's still, the goal is we've carried it out fairly well. John, in specific answer to your question, the statute does talk about planning being done at a town level. It even though it is heavily regulated, it is something that's supposed to be handled locally.
Up to the voters.
Some towns have appointed planning boards, some have elected, some have different terms, but it is something that is supposed to be, the state wants it done at the local level, but the state wants you to administer the state law at a local level. And it does talk specifically about the particular towns. So we can't regionalize a planning board.
Okay. Any other comments?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Do you have another copy of that, by chance? Of that one? I didn't get a copy.
Oh, sure.
Okay. Yeah, I got it in that box earlier.
Oh. But got a lot.
Actually, we'll just start working back now.
Do you want me to come up, or you want
no,
me to
you're
stay?
Fine.
All right, okay. All right. Treasurer's office. For strengths, I'll start as others have and said we have a lot of skill and experience in our office. There are two people in our office. Me as the elected treasurer and Joan Zusko as the appointed assistant treasurer. Joan's been there for 16, 17 years, and so she's had very direct experience, obviously, with what's going on in that office. In my law practice, which I was in for close to 25, 30 years, I had a very heavy emphasis in anything that was related to financial matters, estate planning, probate accountings, tax filings, a lot of things so that my exposure and bringing those, bringing that into the treasurer's office, I'm very comfortable with all the financial things that we've been handling, especially since I also spent 9 years on finance committee and understand the municipal financing is different than in other areas. However, I've had a bit of that background too. So we've spent some, we've been able to get a handle on things there over my first few months. Another strength would be our outside financial advisors. Connie Michikowski put together a great team of outside advisors. I am impressed with everyone that has come in and that we've met with, and we've been able to schedule some extra meetings. Our OPEB advisor, our long-term debt financial advisor, they're really good. I have not needed to, I'm no interest in changing much in the way of our banking and advisors, except to make greater use of them in the months ahead, because we have a lot of things on that need some extra attention. I'm happy with how VEDAR has been working, my access to it. We have tax title program on VEDAR. Working with the general ledger. Again, on finance committee, I was working with through VEDAR for the last 5 years, so that's not been a problem at all. We also have some great, another strength is our systems that we have with the banks, with payroll. A lot of things we can do right from our office. We have received turnovers from departments, a stack of checks, and we're able to run them right through the scanner and get them into our account before the department heads back to their office, literally. That works great. We also can upload checks from FADAR and print out checks, and so that's all happening. The checks get uploaded to our bank account so that they know that it's coming. The bank only approves checks that have been uploaded, so we have a complete, a very nice secure system with People's Bank as far as payment of our payroll and vendor checks. So I'm really happy with that system. As far as weaknesses, it's interesting because this was done a couple of months ago. This was in July when we were still struggling with a backlog in balancing accounts. We did have, it was a not the easiest year in the treasurer's office. We actually had three different treasurers, counting me. And there was a backlog of balancing bank statements and against the general ledger, against the cash book. And so I spent a lot of the first few months taking that right back to July 1, 2014. So we did actually the entire fiscal year balancing it and going back and dealing with the transactions and revenues and expenses and seeing what we had as a fund balance at the beginning of the year. It was time consuming. It kept us from dealing with some of the other issues. And so that was part of what I wrote up with my SWAT in the middle of July. Since then, we have gotten everything cleared back to the beginning of the fiscal year. We have worked with the auditor. We have made adjustments to the accounts, so now everything is squared away. We're ready for going forward, and I'm really happy with that we don't have to continue, you know, poking back through the past. And I really feel like over the last few weeks, because this only happened about 3 weeks ago with the auditor, that we've been able to focus our attention and going ahead, and that's been great. A weakness, computers. Our computers are slow. Yesterday, my work on the computer crashed on me 3 times. That was not typical. It doesn't crash 3 times a day. But there are times when we get dropped from internet, and it's right as I'm in the middle of making one of these checking deposits that just says, you've been disconnected. And then I have to wait. Fortunately, I've always got another pile of things to work on over here until the computer screen says, you're connected again, and then I proceed and put in the next check. It's frustrating. So I don't know whether it's the internet or the computers or what, or the programs or what, but I really think we need some attention in that area. I mentioned telephones, but we don't spend a lot of time on the telephone, but they are kind of clunky and outdated, and transferring calls. I still don't know how to transfer calls. And when I receive the transfers from other offices, it's hard. There's something, it seems like each time it's not like the time before. So anyways, that's a weakness. Opportunities. I had mentioned in my SWAT that we have so many people in this town with good, solid financial backgrounds that we could make use of. It's really sad for me to see that we're not getting more people stepping forward to finance committee. I think we really need finance committee. I think we need that extra level of financial advice. There are certain things where I talk with others in town, well, that's the treasurer's decision. Fine, that's the treasurer's decision. But it's the treasurer's decision after gathering good information from a lot of other people, after gathering good advice. And so there are people certainly that I can call on, but I would love to get a good finance committee running again, and I would love to also get some kind of a financial advisory committee, a group that we can come in and say, what do you think we should be doing with these investments? Should we be more aggressive at this time or not? Should we stay more conservative? Is this a good deal over here or not a good deal? What do you think of this capital OPEB plan that we've set up? Does this make sense over time to you? And though I think that we have people in this town that would be happy to come in and give that kind of advice. I haven't really gotten that going yet. As I said, I was working backwards, now I'm working forward. Threats, busy. We're just really busy, and I think you'll hear that from everybody. I love doing what I do. I spend a lot of hours here. I'm pretty much here 8:30 or 9 till 6 or 7 at night because I want to be here. because I'm trying to get through every file and trying to figure it out and get it going. That's too much of an expectation for anyone else who would take that position. It's too much to expect, I think, from, we have an assistant treasurer who, when she's caught up in something, will do the same thing. We're doing a constant juggle of, okay, there's a lot of comp hours and now you need a few days off. And so this is a constant juggling act. She's taking extra comp time this week. I know when she comes in next week, she'll probably put in some extra hours, at least 2 or 3 days. This is just the way it is. This is how work is getting done in the treasurer's office, and I feel like it is getting done. But it's not a good, I'd like to see something better. I'd like to see that stabilized somewhat. And maybe it will. Maybe it's just I've only been there 5 months, and maybe we really can get that better stabilized. That's certainly a goal of mine. So that's it for my SWOT. You asked about an organizational chart, and I told you it's me and it's Joan. But in lieu of organizational chart, I didn't hand this out because I know what it's like to receive something at the beginning of a meeting and not knowing what, but I can leave it with you. I have a few pages on what it is that the treasurer does and what it is the assistant treasurer does. So how we, at this point at least, are dividing up the responsibilities. But more than how it's divided up, I think it's interesting to see the extent, the number of different things that are happening out of that office, which I would say is certainly a surprise to me, the number of different things that are handled out of the treasurer's office. So over time, I'd like to see that addressed. I need more time in the job to see, you know, how that should be handled or could be handled differently. So that's it.
Questions?
Regarding the computers going down, mm-hmm. We have everybody sitting here. Is it a townwide problem that everybody has the exact same problem?
Yes.
Okay, and how often does it happen in your office a week, Dan?
It's not happening in the downstairs as much anymore.
It hasn't happened as much since we came back and we're hardwired.
Right.
I would say
they're
our
not
office
hardwired up here.
Okay.
It was 4 or 5 times a day in my office before.
Yeah.
And that's what's happening upstairs now.
Okay.
Well, with the updated system that we've put in, the improvement that we did, can we get the wires up here?
That shouldn't be a problem. We've got some money left over so that we can take care of the hard wiring for data. Was it Normando Communications that did that work?
The wiring?
Yeah.
Yes.
See, I wouldn't have known that we needed that because before we moved, I wasn't having that kind of trouble. That's interesting.
Gail is the only one up here, I think, that's hardwired.
Gail is.
And that wiring needs to be changed big time.
Basically, from Jess's office west, everybody was having major connectivity issues.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if it has to do with the vault downstairs blocking the signal or impacting the signal. But
now or before?
Before.
Okay.
Now we're fine.
Okay.
We're hardwired.
They're hardwired. We're not, and it's problematic.
The RFP that you just approved for Northeast IT, that's exactly what they're going to be ferreting out.
Yeah.
Okay. Any other questions?
Oh, I just have one on the human. You mentioned human resources in here. And
yes.
I mean, just to be clear, from what people would consider to be a traditional human resource function, the treasurer's department has really been the payroll and employee benefits.
Correct.
Right. So, when we think about human resources, are you suggesting we need a more robust human resource function? Are you suggesting it be
we are? Well, we're not doing that part of it.
Right.
So, need it? I think that the town may need.
Mm-hmm.
I think it. Where is it? You're pretty much you, isn't it? As far as when it's an issue beyond handling benefits,
employee benefits.
I mean, and we want to do more in that area. We're going to be reviewing all of the employee benefits that we've got that booked. As you'll see here, I've got everything. I think it's booked month by month as to when we're going to tackle what issue. But we're going to be handling the employee benefits as far as what benefits do we offer. Are these the best ones? We know we don't want to add more because of the administrative overhead, but maybe we're going to trade something out. So that's an area we're going to study. That's the kind of employee mm-hmm. benefits treasurer's office does. We don't. I actually saw on my SWOT, I kind of went, oh dear, what did I mean? I put hiring and firing. We don't do hiring and firing.
That's what
I guess I had it in there because we do the intake forms and the exit packages. So no, we do not do that level of hiring, of human resources. When it's those level of issues, it's pretty much your responsibility. And you handle it on a daily basis. Whatever. So,
whatever happened with
that
conversation.
I apologize for putting that in.
Did that conversation with Sunderland and somebody else ever go anywhere?
It didn't go anywhere. We had a couple of meetings about a shared human resource function between six towns, and we were working with the Franklin Regional Council of Governments. And I think it withered on the vine when Margaret moved off to Rutland. Uh-huh. I can reach out to Bob Dean again and find out where this may stand. But I think I said this about a year ago, that human resource functions, the administration seems to be a job in and of itself, but human resource functions for the town is a critical need. One of the things we'll be talking about at our safety committee meeting next Tuesday is whether we go for a grant to further our efforts in that direction. But I think two people in one office handling all of the human resource issues that come up apart from discipline, that's not a sustainable model for the long term.
Great. Thank you.
Do you want me to
yes,
you
please.
Now?
Do you? I got just one more.
Thank you.
Don't do any electronic bill paying now at all, or just limited?
We do a lot of the payroll is direct deposit,
yeah.
So that's electronic. There's
no,
still a portion
for vendors.
So for vendors. Our large a number of payments are handled by wire, but not a normal vendor, not a bill that comes in. We wire our loan payments and retirement fund payments, and some of those larger ones.
Bank transactions, not actual vendors.
Exactly, bank transactions. Yes, and they're approved and phone calls and all, and they have to be. So we're a little bit wary. We're concerned about security first of all. So even if there are some things like that might save some time, and we don't have to print out 30 checks because we can do it online, we always want to make sure that we've got security to our banking lines.
And how much savings would there be in a biweekly payroll?
There would be, it's savings in different ways. I was looking at the bill, the difference between a direct deposit employee and a check, it's 80 cents. So, I mean, there are a lot of things like that add up in differences. If we can get direct deposit, that's going to bring in a savings. As far as those that have paying weekly versus biweekly, there is a cost per transaction with our payroll service. So yes, we would cut. I wouldn't cut it in half because, as it is, more than half of our employees are on biweekly because that is all the school and they are the chunk of our employees. So what we would be cutting out is the extra week for a smaller number of employees, which is all the town and police, fire, highway, and town hall, and all the others that are not all non-school. So that would be a savings of several hundred dollars a month. That also then we'd also have to take into account that we barely finish a payroll and we're starting the next one. I mean, literally, people come in, pick up their checks, and drop off their timesheets just like this on Fridays. There's always something going on with payroll. There's no week in which one or the other of us can just take a vacation and go away and know that the other one isn't going to be having to drop a number of other things and just do payroll because payroll's a big deal. And there are some things about it that might be able to be simplified. This is what I'm still working on. We are meeting with payroll services next week. We have three new ones coming in with that basic question of just what you're asking, what would it save us to go. What's your biweekly quote? What's your weekly quote? So we can see the difference there. What other services can you provide for how much more that might be taking up time? How many of the payroll employee deductions that are then paid off in other directions? How much can those services provide to us and at what cost? And what is direct deposit versus
Is 50% of the town on direct deposit right now, roughly?
I would say more than 50%.
Oh, so.
Yeah. The school helped us out. I mentioned that we were going to be trying to go to direct deposit, and somehow the message got over that it was required. And so we have a lot of people on direct deposit now. And, so that there is some, and it's not just that's not our only option for savings. Sometimes with direct deposit, you see right now, those people also get a complete stub. So we really can't tell what our stack of checks that come in, what are checks and what are stubs. But another option we'd have then would be online. Online, you could log in and find your own current year-to-date stub. So there would be that savings too. There would be no delivery person. There's a delivery charge on a weekly basis. It's not huge, but it's every single week. The guy is paid to come and walk upstairs and plunk a pile of checks on our desk.
And it's also the inquiries that go along with it, because people can be self-sufficient and look up their own information and not have to go to Joan and ask her to print out last year's W-2.
We do that. Anytime someone finances or is buying something, I need the last two pay stubs. Mm-hmm. They were given to you. Well, I don't keep them. Mm-hmm. So it's, yes, exactly. There is a number of at a time that takes up.
So. Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, after hearing the three before me, I know a lot of my strengths, weaknesses are really redundant, so I'm just going to quickly go through from the bullets that I gave you. I gave you a nice, easy one-pager. starting with the strength, obviously the interoffice communication, to emphasize, the town hall right now works really well together. I think we are interested enough in each other's offices that if we need help in another office, we actually do that for each other, which again might not stay the same given a different group of people. Right now that's a great big strength, as well as the current employees' outside abilities that they're able to take in and use for their job. Sue, working for insurance for years, has done a lot of research saving us on insurance and things like that. Linda, obviously, with her having her law degree, I had my own business, so I'm good with the time management customer service. And we're fortunate to have those people not only have those abilities, but to apply it. Another strength of my office, I believe, is my availability. I can't tell you how many times I've come in for birth records, oaths of office, posting meetings at the last moment, at
unknown
hours, and marriage intentions, yes. But I'm always available. I live close. That's one of the benefits of living in a small town, and I'm happy to be there to help them. I'm also approachable. My office is very approachable. I joke that my office is in Switzerland, which means I'm neutral. I don't take large quantities of money from anybody. They come in needing something, and hopefully I can help them. I'm also fortunate. I have Janice for a few hours. I have Pat for 10 hours. All of my election workers are very efficient and good at what they do. Therefore, I look good because they look good. And the fact that I pretty much work with every single department and committee in some way. So I know that. Another strength is our town code. I can't tell you how much I love it. Getting people, I still field questions and calls from people, but I'm able to navigate through it with them. And so I know I'm not getting a lot of calls I normally would if we didn't have it. Another strength, obviously, is our virtual town hall. Those who are active on it is another great resource of, quick question information. But I know, and I'll get to that later, the weaknesses are the virtual town hall, people who aren't active, aren't using that potential of what it can do. So then for the weaknesses, obviously, budget is always a big one on everyone's weakness list. Sometimes a big weakness with the budget is not being able to afford the opportunities that you ask us to present you. So that kind of, where Bill said, kind of conflicts a little bit. Another big weakness, the IT department. Again, the technology is an awesome thing, but you have to know how to use it. And there are so many things, I think we're all literate on the programs we individually have to work with, but there's a lot of simple things. I get so frustrated when something should take me 30 seconds and I spend 20 minutes trying to figure out how to do it. So I know if we had like an IT or any issues that came up, they could address that. Again, the virtual town hall and active, which I already addressed. I don't know if it's a weakness, more if it's a frustration, is how idealistically versus realistically, when all these studies get done and everyone gives us, okay, well, you know, idealistically you should have this, this, or this, but we need to focus more on, well, realistically, what can we have? So, because all these studies are going to tell you the best case scenario, mm-hmm. which we kind of, in the back of our minds, know it's not going to happen. So I think that's a weakness. Sorry. opportunities, yeah. Opportunities for my office is conferences. Not only do you get education, but you make a lot of connections. Town clerks have a great contact base where if I have a problem or a question, I can reach out to 350 clerks in cities and towns instantly. And there's always a good response for that. Other opportunities is the software technologies that they have available now. Births and deaths, I don't know if anyone knows or is interested, but births and deaths, vital records are now available online within Mass. From 1989 up, which is amazing. It's so quick, so efficient. Everything prior to that, obviously, we still have to go to the vault. But that's a great, new software is always great. Another opportunity that I try to take advantage of is town events. Again, trying to be visible and approachable and helpful to the community in any way. Threats, unfunded mandates. Obviously, that's a big one. Auto mark that we're required to pay for state elections that nobody has used. 6 years, and we're required to get the Discord every state election at the cost of like $600 to $800. Another things that might be coming up is potential surcharge of the vital records. This great program I'm talking about, having it be 1989 and up, the state now wants cities and towns to possibly pay for use of that. So that's another surcharge that might happen, and there's always talk about potential surcharges for dog licenses. So those are threats to my office. And I'd say the biggest threat would be the lack of, you guys touched on it, is public interest, vacancy on volunteer boards, town meetings, elections. The interest just isn't there. I know David and I, a few years back, you know, tried to do our PSA thing going on. I racked my brain trying how to educate people more about events that are going on when ultimately it relies on them to ask and find out themselves on a lot of things. Any questions?
Conferences, you were able to attend them and they're helpful?
The ones I have attended the past couple years have been conflicts. One went interested a few years ago, and then some, you know, special, you know, overrides that people throw on me. But, but I try to attend them as much as I can, yes.
So what is it you have to buy for every election?
What?
The auto mark. The auto mark, and forgive me, I misspoke, the state provides the auto mark for the state elections. But for all of our local elections, all of our overrides, it is the handicap accessible machine, which is great, and if one person used it, then it'd be absolutely worth it. We're fortunate we're only one precinct in town. There are cities and towns that have 20-something precincts, and they're required to have that and pay for it. And a lot of times people say that just nobody uses it, but the state mandates us to.
Thank you. Any other questions?
Sorry, I'm quick.
Yeah, that's fine. Thank you very much. All right, we'll just keep going.
Okay. I did this from the perspective of more of an organizational than a departmental viewpoint. Internal strengths, familiarity with the majority of the residents due to the fact that many of the employees have worked in town for many years, good camaraderie amongst departments, willingness to help out other departments, diverse previous employment histories, and education allows a wealth of experience in areas other than municipal administration. Our safety committee, not only does the committee identify safety concerns, but the committee generates credit towards our property and casualty insurance premium. Buildings committee, this committee has hopefully and will continue to tackle the problem of our aging buildings. Internal weaknesses, bench strength in my office, like everybody else in town hall, they have pretty much two people, one person sick or the other's on vacation. It's tough. IT, a dedicated IT person rather than an outside vendor would be preferable to me. With only two computers in my office, if there's an issue, time is essential, and a lot of times Fergus is like, yeah, we'll get there when we can get there. Human resource director is needed. A personnel board should be considered to ensure equitable hiring and compensation practices. Change in bylaws that limit revenues, i.e. big box development. Maintenance on buildings has continually been deferred. The cost of repair and or replace due to deferred maintenance is unaffordable. Follow through on various studies that are approved, funded, and never completed, or if completed, never acted upon. External opportunities, grant programs such as the rewards program that Maya offers. We were able to get two $5,000 grants each of the last 2 years, and we're working on this year's various grants through the safety committee. External threats, the unfunded mandates, the moratorium on the new gas connections by Berkshire Gas, and state and federal nonprofit purchases of land, which reduce our tax base.
Any questions? They're picking up the pace on us here. We have to pay more. No questions?
That was very observing. You must have watched the last 10 of our meetings because we spoke about every one of these.
I have no life. I always watch meetings.
So can I just ask a question about the software?
Sure.
I know there's been some conversation in the past about the opportunity to get everybody on, well, actually Tim brought it up too tonight, just getting everybody on the same platform.
Yep.
Is that something that, I know you've looked at other, I don't even know the name of the software you're using right now, but there are other packages.
It's Point. Yeah.
Yeah, Point. Is that something that you'd be?
I would be amenable to it if it weren't Vadar. Their collection software is has issues.
Okay. Yep.
I mean, Munis would be phenomenal, but it's a bazillion dollars.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, yeah.
Yeah.
So.
Munis is awful.
Compared to Point, you've never seen our Point system.
it takes me 4 clicks to approve a purchase order in Munis. Kind of open it, select it. Select it again, approve it. Select it again, approve it. Select it again, approve it. So 4
okay,
selections.
So compared to our
so,
purchase
but
order system?
I've seen their collection system, and it's phenomenal.
Okay.
Yeah. So I think each
module.
Well, no, and I think I think each vendor has an area where they really excel.
They say Munis.
Munis is good in the collections. And Treasurer's Office, I've heard that.
That's where they started from.
So. Yeah, exactly. But they have a buildings module. Point has, did Scott Schwinnier speak
yeah,
to you?
It's the price. It comes down to price.
Yeah.
It is huge.
He was surprised how many permits that we issue in this town.
I'm sure.
And it was tenfold for what I'm paying for now. But I mean, we're very limited in what we can do with what we have.
Exactly.
All right.
Based on the conversations that we've had already, can you interject any information as to how these people's lives are going to be easier, Molly, with the new IT people that we're bringing forth?
I can interject what I'm hopeful of.
Okay. Well, I mean,
I can't speak
that's you know.
The whole idea of going out and doing this RFP was to get somebody other than, and interestingly, the current provider didn't even bother to respond to the RFP, which we thought was quite telling.
Well, we seem to be upset with
but
that.
To get an experienced IT group of professionals to go in and the game plan, and you can see the proposals that they put forth is they're going to go in and interview everybody, take an inventory of everything that we currently have, and then really lay out the way things should work. And to somebody's point, Jessica, I think you said it, I mean, it may very well be that they say, you know, you really should have this, but we're going to have to figure out how to get from point A to point B, and it may not be, you know, nirvana overnight, but under any set of circumstances, it has to have electronic storage capability, networking, you people should be able to talk to each other, share documents, integration, workflow analysis, all of that. So those systems are out there. Yeah, a lot of them are pricey, but I mean, we're quite frankly, it seems like so far off the eight ball that we can make marked and immediate improvement in fairly short order.
We did have a study done in 07 or 08. They came in, talked to us all, what did you want, that type of thing. Yes, we'd all like to be networked, and...
It's as far as the way.
Yeah.
Well, and that's up to all of us to push that through. I mean, I think we've all heard enough during the last couple of budget cycles and certainly the SWOT analysis. I mean, I think every single department so far has had IT, you as well, on their SWOT analysis as an area of weakness. And it comes down to opportunity cost.
Exactly.
I mean, spending $100,000 may seem like a god-awful amount of money, but when you find out that X number of hours of highly trained, intelligent individuals are pushing paper for X number of hours a week is costing the town an awful lot more money than if everybody could put their brains to, better tasks.
And waiting 20 minutes for a response on a simple question.
So if I could throw in one thing, the only reason Planning Board didn't raise IT is that I'm completely off your system. Mm-hmm. I have no interconnection with Town Hall in any way. My email does run through the, whatever the email program is, but my operation is completely separate, so I'm not complaining about IT in that way, but there is no interconnect, and there's no interconnect with the ZBA. I'm not sure, I can't speak for the Conservation Commission. They have a presence in the building, but I don't know how plugged in they are.
But you talked even about, you used GIS as an example. I mean, this is all technology related, and to your point, Bill, there are certain liberties that are being taken with what I would refer to as private systems, if you will, that are the town's leveraging off of the fact that you have computers in your own office rather than the town actually providing that, and that's not, as you said, sustainable.
One thing that might be interesting is if we actually got the dark fiber from the five colleges lit.
Well, that's what I was just going to ask about. Yeah. What is the status of that? It's dropped here, but...
They haven't lit as up yet. That costs money.
Of course.
Yeah, but don't they want a building in this town?
Well, can I actually speak to that? Because two different people from five colleges have approached me and indicated that they are wanting to have that discussion.
They have certainly implied to us that it is available, but we're not using it.
That's what I've been told. So, I mean, I know you're saying it's not lit, but I'm hearing from five colleges that they're just scratching their heads wondering why we haven't already been using it.
They're telling us that that's one of the things they do for the town, so we shouldn't say that they're not offering us anything.
Yeah, and my conversations were completely separate and apart from anything to do with, the recent building. I mean, this has been over the past year or so.
I mean, the dark fiber is lit to certain buildings, so the public safety complex is lit, but not Town Hall. So if five colleges wants to come and talk to us about how they're going to provide the wherewithal in order for us to take advantage of that fiber, by all means,
hopefully the Northeast IT Consulting should have a conversation with five colleges and have that part of their knowledge base when they make recommendations. So we'll make sure that happens.
Because five colleges has a really slick network.
Good.
Doesn't go down. It's very good.
Thank you.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I did this also on a departmental and townwide basis. Some of the strengths, personnel, like everybody else has said, the department personnel in my office has been there quite a while. We're all well trained. For the town, the same thing. Most of the departments, people have been here a long time and they work well together. One of the things in our office we've done, a strength, is IT. In the last 4 or 5 years, we brought online mapping. We were able to work with our mappers to get, at virtually no cost, digital mapping. And we now have online maps and a GIS system that we pay about $1,800 a year to run. That's actually one of the weaknesses as well. Aside from information that they've been able to obtain from us and the Pioneer Valley Planning Commission, there's virtually nothing on our maps other than our parcel maps. and wetlands, flood, those overlays are there, but there's nothing else that could be brought up. We've recently added all the buildings to the maps, so you could go on and all the buildings are outlined. If you just want the map itself, not a photo, it's got all the buildings from, I want to say it's about 4 years ago was the last flyby that they used, but those have all been added in. Weaknesses, staffing, our hours since I've been there have been cut a lot. Department of Revenue, as you know, is reorganizing, restructuring, retiring. The last 10 years, when we've done revals, each reval, we get pushed closer and closer to not being able to send out bills. The work that they used to do gets shifted to us. The review work that they do now is getting delayed and delayed. The last time, last year, we were done on time around Columbus Day. We did not get approval. It was a couple days before Christmas when we were supposed to have approval, probably around Veterans Day.
But the bills still went out.
But we got the bills out on time. Another weakness is lack of revaluation funding. We've been doing the revals. We're doing the revals and the annual updates for about $600 a year, which is also a strength. Most communities are spending probably around $10,000 for an intramural adjustment and anywhere from $30,000 to $60,000 for the every 3 year recertification process, hiring outside vendors. Some of the weaknesses, IT, as everybody else said, I've been there 25 years. I'm on my third computer in the department in 25 years, which since technology seems to become obsolete after 2 years, we tend to be using an obsolete computer for most of the time that I've been there. I think, as Susan said, there needs to be a personnel board established to review staffing. The last probably half dozen budget cycles, we've been told level service budgets, but invariably one department comes in and says, well, we need more hours, and they make a good case, as I'm sure all the departments in town could make a case for, but since they're the only ones that come forward, they seem to get different treatment and get 5 hours, 10 hours, a new position added, and that really needs to be evaluated on a townwide basis, I think, rather than just looking at each individual department as being separate. Zoning, we need to look at the zoning bylaws. I said at the long range planning meeting the other night, our new growth commercially is down from about 200,000 a year. Now it's down to about 40 in commercial. We need to look at the 70,000 square foot building cap size. There's not a whole lot of parcels where you could fit a building of that size, but we need to look at maybe reevaluating that in the near future, where we could get different types of large scale buildings in town. Opportunities, technology, we continue to look for any kind of inexpensive opportunity to add, like we did with the maps and the GIS. Same thing with the town. We should be looking at any kind of grants that we have. Threats, surprisingly, Department of Revenue. They continually cut. This year they had, I believe it's about 10 people take early retirement. And they didn't replace any people. So I'm assuming that the form approval process is going to get dragged out even longer. And threats, on a townwide basis, I've got personnel. As you know from the water treatment plant, as people leave, it's going to get more expensive to hire replacements. And there's a lot of people here that are getting not extremely close to retirement age, but in the next few years, maybe looking at retiring. And that's something that the town might be in for a surprise when they're going to hire new people, replacements.
I'm just polling.
Our ages?
No, retirement. Any questions?
Can I ask?
Yeah.
Dan, when you were talking about the lack of adequate revaluation funding,
Yeah. So
the state was limited, or the department was limited to $600 a year for reval funding. I'm sorry, I'm just ignorant. What does that mean?
That's how much we get from the town in our budget for revaluation.
But what do you use it for?
A lot of that is if we have to mail out impact notices, we need to buy Marshall and Swift every 3 years. That runs anywhere between $500 and $800. With a lot of the commercial in town, we need to buy dollars and cents of shopping centers. That runs a couple hundred dollars. So we've got to really budget and plan the purchases, and hopefully there's some kind of a surplus that we can utilize at the end of the fiscal year.
And you said that compares, like, other towns can spend up to like $10,000?
Most towns, these functions aren't handled internally.
What Dan's not saying is he's doing it.
Yeah, we do that in-house.
Vendor.
The annual updates, DOR now requires us to adjust the values annually.
Yep.
They come in every 3 years, but they require every year. They're looking to move that to 4 years.
Right.
And that might take place as early as next year.
Okay.
But most towns our size spend probably about $10,000 a year.
Because they hire somebody.
They hire somebody from outside to come in and calculate all the commercial and residential values. And then the big year when DOR comes in, it's substantially more.
Mm-hmm. Any other questions? I have one.
Yeah.
So you gave us the job description in your department, which I have never seen them completely. So the water and sewer billing
that's
is handled
the
in
most recent. No, that's the most recent job description that we have.
Okay.
For that, when the pay plan was put through in '98, water and sewer billing. Right now I have a shared clerk with the Board of Selectmen 10 hours, my office 5 hours, and the clerk 5 hours.
Okay.
When that job description was drawn up, I had a clerk for 20 hours a week. Water had 10 hours a week, and sewer had 5 hours a week. And all the bill preparation and recording, the collector's office handled the collections, but they would turn the invoices over, and everything was done out of shared office.
Since 05. It's all been handled out of the collector's office.
Okay, that's what I thought, because I saw that.
Yeah, the job description that's in there, basically, for my clerical, relates to just assessors.
Assessors, okay.
That's listed.
And that was in response to the org chart with the functions that are being performed, so I assume that...
Yeah, the functions are pretty standard.
Standard,
that's
yeah.
Pretty much a good description of what we do, with the exception of the water sewer.
Right, yeah, ignoring that piece. Yeah, and one of the reasons that I had asked for that too at the last meeting was also trying to get a handle on a backup plan. You know, if somebody's out, where are we really at risk for somebody else having no clue on how to do that job function? So having the functional description of what's happening in each department is extremely helpful.
Thank you.
We always save the best department for last, right?
DPW. I'll start off with the functions, which we were just discussing previously, what each division does. The highway division is in charge of maintaining, of course, the roads, bridges, ditches, sidewalks, and also the Connecticut River Dike, town trees, and of course, snow removal and any other related emergencies that come up. Just like to say that the highway budget is about 80% of it is weather related. If we have a hard winter or if we have an easy winter, it all depends on that. There are 63 miles of roads, including the dirt roads. The functions of the wastewater division consist of the treatment, maintenance of the sewer system, and replacement of aging sewer lines. There are 9 pump stations plus the treatment plant. I won't go into details on where these are. The wastewater division plant, of course, is behind the highway garage, and the wastewater division is also responsible for inspections of grease traps, restaurants, and new sewer services, and there are 968 sewer connections and over 21 miles of sewer lines. The main function of the water division, of course, is to provide the town with clean, safe drinking water. There are sections of town that still do not have water lines. there's a section, Aquavita Road, North Hadley Road, Mountain Road, Honey Pot Road, parts of Cemetery Road, Cross Path, Moody Bridge, the dirt section, which has been talked about for many years of not doing it, the dirt section, East Hadley Road, most of Mill Valley, and a section of the other part of Mill Valley towards the Amherst Town line. It's only partially has a water line through there. They're also, the Water Division also has to do monthly testing of water meter readings, testing, inspection of backflow devices, testing of meters, inspection, repair of water mains, which is a big thing, and fire hydrant special meter readings. The, on average, the town uses around 700 gallons of water per day. In the summertime, of course, that goes up to over a million because of the usage. The town has two storage tanks, two locations, one on Mount Holyoke and one on Mount Water. And there are 2,223 service connections in the town of Hadley for everything, the businesses, the homes, everything. And there are 260 backflow devices that have to be tested twice a year. And there is 65 miles of water. I mean, I could leave this with the board later if you wish. On to the SWOT analysis with the strengths, weaknesses. As we know, we have a pretty strong management team right now. We have people that have been in their positions for many years. My foreman has been there 25 years. The secretary, administrative assistants have been there 12 and 15 years. So they keep the division running smoothly with all the phone calls, all the complaints, all the issues that come up. And also like to mention that we're very fortunate to have a good mechanic, which sometimes is a hard thing to come up with because he knows and can fix equipment, and he went to school to learn all this. One of the biggest strengths, of course, is the upkeep of the Hadley roads. As we all know, in the wintertime, that we have to stay on top of the snow and ice. In the summertime, we have to stay on top of the potholes and, of course, any complaints that come through the board, through my office to repair potholes or to fix culvert pipes or to dig ditches or whatever. Another new strength, which just started a few years ago, is the new salting program, which, of course, as we know, we do not have to sweep the roads. We do not have to clean the catch basins because we are just using salt. So that is a savings to the town. Some of the weaknesses. Qualified employees, as we just went through this with the water department. I've been going through applications, trying to fish through the best ones, trying to get the best that we can for what we have, and it's pretty difficult to come up with people that want to do these type of works for the pay that we want to give them. Gary Berg, as you know, is part of our organization, but he's just part of the building maintenance, let's say. He's kind of doing mostly that nowadays. Shortage, as every department has, of funds. Outside services are needed for certain things, like, let's say, mowing the top of the dike. We have to contract that. That service, of course, goes up every year. The paving prices, of course, go up every year, so everything, you know, has to fall into place. And, you know, repairs to individual replacement of culvert pipes, guardrails, catch basins, you know, stuff like that aren't getting done, let's say, to the extent that they should. We just don't have the money to do that. We have Chapter 90, but of course that is used just basically for paving. And of course we get to another weakness is the lack of facilities, which we all are aware of down the DPW. They've been temporary trailers for 9 years already, and they're kind of getting to the point of no return, as they say. They're starting to show wear and tear. And they're not very efficient, of course, in the wintertime to keep relatively warm and in the summer to keep relatively cool. So what we are hoping to get in the future is a new building, new offices, a new area for our vehicles, because a lot of the vehicles, as we know right now, are outside and they should be undercover to protect them, you know, for the usage that they have to go through. In the middle of winter, it's kind of difficult to start a truck that's been sitting outside. John Washkevitz can attest to it. That's been sitting outside that we need, you know, to go plow snow. Another weakness is, of course, is equipment replacement. It is behind schedule. I mean, we go to the capital planning, and we tell them what we need. We go to town meeting, they approve it, they go to the override, it fails, we go back and forth, and trying to catch up on the replacement schedule. So what we have done in the past is use the surplus equipment, which we have been able to get from various agencies, but now that seems to be drying up. The only place that I have any luck is with the fire department getting us a wonderful power grader that I am very thankful for, that has saved us a lot of money over the time that it's been here compared to what the 40-year-old piece that we had before that, and some one-tons or pickup trucks that the fire department has supplied. They have to have the fireplace on them. Another issue near and dear to my heart, which has always been, of course, for weakness, is the lack of tree care. I mean, a lot of trees in town. I go out every year, I look at these trees, I see them every day. I could go on and on. I mean, there's a tremendous amount of work that could be done on the trees, especially when it comes to trimming. Because if you don't trim a tree after a while, it's just not going to survive because it just didn't have any care of taking care of it. And of course, Hadley's Tree Belt is one of the greatest around here and on the West Street Common, of course, with the trees on the sides of the road, which there are two rows of trees, which probably should be only one. Let's go to opportunities. We all know that we have Chapter 90. We all know that we can get a TIP grant, Transportation Improvement Grant. We applied for a FLAP grant for Booty Bridge Road to resurface the part that is now still gravel. We haven't heard whether or not we have got that grant yet or not. That is in the works. We are supposed to hear from the DCR, let's say mid or end of September, whether or not.
Did we apply or did they apply for that?
We jointly applied. Okay. We did our share and they put in their share.
Okay.
It's a matching grant. We'll have to come up with some in-house funding to do that, and our labor could be used, our engineering could be used for the in-house part that is required. FEMA money, which we all know after a tremendously, you know, hard winter or a tremendously bad snowstorm or Michael burst, I mean, can be very costly. Washouts can be very costly. So there's a good source of money for that. David Nixon, the town administrator, applied and successfully got a Mass Works grant for the Shattuck Road extension. That extension included the water line, but it also included paving a section of dirt road that needed a lot of repair and care over the year, and even in the winter it was very difficult to try to keep it up because of the potholes and the ice. And a good note on this is, we're talking about opportunities here, is the state took over the portion of, let's say, DeWire's Bridge, or now they call it Bridge Over Russell Brook. Let's say that the state now is going to be funding this instead of the town coming up with a tremendous amount of money trying to get this accomplished, because the bridge reports come out every year and there is some deficiencies on it and they're not going to get any better. David and I met with the state asking them for financial help, and they agreed to do that. It's not on their radar for next year or the year after. It's probably 5 years down the road, but that is a big, big help to Hadley, because it's a funding source that we do not have to come up with, because the state is going to be taking it over, doing the design and doing the work on it. The threats, of course, we all have them, and the requirements that come out, the mandates that come out, the new stormwater regulations, which I spoke to David Nixon about, are going to be very costly. It's a five-year program. The first year, I believe, is like $171,000 or $174,000 just to start the program off. By the time we get done, after the 5 years, it's going to be over $700,000 to accomplish this. Of course, it's more than just mapping. It's more than just testing. You have to do the whole town. You have to see what contaminants are. I think Guilford, you're probably more aware of this in Amherst about, you know, a stormwater requirement, what is required of a town to do this. Transfer station, another threat, of course. It's closed. We know that. We're doing the testing. getting difficult to be dealing with an engineering firm. Since that time, we switched to a different engineering firm to get the testing done. This way here, we will remain in compliance, because one thing Hadley does not want is a notice of non-compliance for the transfer station because something wasn't done, because the engineering firm was too lax on it, let's say, to get it done in time. Another big item, very important to the town of Hadley, is the dike as a threat. I mean, if the board remembers, we had, I think Jerry was on the board when we had that major one where we had to actually drive in pilings into the dike itself to secure it. I mean, it was, for a while there, was pretty scary whether or not we could get it repaired in time before high water came. I mean, it's a situation. Mike Spanknebel was involved with that. We had many meetings on this, whether or not we could get this fixed in time. So that is a major threat. And the last major threat, of course, is equipment, which we all know, especially in the wintertime, especially if you have a blizzard, it can be very hard to try to keep running, very hard to try to keep up, and very costly, because when it breaks, they say, well, the parts won't be in until Monday, it's Friday afternoon or Tuesday or Wednesday. So it does put a definite strain on our abilities to keep the roads maintained at all times, especially when it's, you know, like we had these snowstorms that are hitting, let's say, a lot. From when I started till now, they seem to be increasing in the amount of time that it snows. Not so much the depth of the snow, but it just likes to snow for like 2 or 3 days here compared to where it would snow for 8 hours, 6 hours, the sun comes out and it's over. So that is due possibly to, let's say, global warming. Let's go on quickly to the water division, because I could spend a couple hours here, which I won't. The strengths of the water division. As we all know, we have a very, very good person that works in the water division, Sharon Gifford. She helps a lot to make sure that everything runs smoothly, to make sure that all the reports are done on time, all the testing is done on time, to make sure that the backflow program is done. She implemented the meter replacement program. There's only, which it says here, 380 meters less. There's even less than that now since this was done. So that is updating our meter system to get it up to the 21st century so that we can just ride by now and it picks up the individual meters off the houses without going to each house, plugging in the gun, and you know, finding out that you have a problem with the meter, which you have to go back. So basically, the meter replacement program is going to save us a lot of time when we have to read meters. It used to take us upwards of a month to read the meters. Some of these meters, you had to go into the house, you had to make appointments. Right now, we're changing these over, you just drive by and it picks them up as you go by, so that's a big savings. And as we all know, another strength is our water treatment plant. It's only 8 years old. It's one of the latest technologies that came up, the ultrafiltration plant. Has great technology and it serves the town well. It has enough capacity for the future for the town's water system. We have money set aside for emergencies. Let's say for we have a lot of hydrants that are bad, or if we have a lot of leaking water valves, we have money set aside. We have funds just for that under the capital plan to use for those specific purposes. We have a new water master plan, which was just done. 2015. Of course, the master plan tells us what we should be doing, what year we should be doing it, and the estimated costs. Of course, it goes into every other detail, which I won't go into, but it tells the whole picture, which we did. I believe the first one was done in 2005, and it was updated, and we just updated again so that we have a program, or at least a guideline to follow, of where do we go next. Which water line will be replaced, what needs to be updated. Okay, back to let's go on to the weaknesses. Very old system, as we all know, water lines, I've mentioned that lots of times. Old undersized mains on sections of roads that have been developed. Let's say Rocky Hill Road has a 4-inch water main, believe it or not, but it does. It's a very old one. East Street, very old, is lots of these all over town, Moody Bridge Road, but the cost to repair these now, of course, every year goes up. The cost of these materials, the cost of even the prevailing wages go up. So that is going to be one of the weaknesses, is to try to play catch up. We have so many that need repair. John Washkevitz has been here for a long time. He knows what we have to deal with when we go through all this to try to fix these. Do we do a permanent patch? Do we do a temporary band-aid on it? Do we place a section? I mean, I could go on and on about it, but I won't. And of course, the lack of funding is a weakness to do all this. We are, of course, going to town meeting for some money to replace the most important water main right in front of us, right up on Route 9, to replace that, because we had way too many breaks and it's way too old, as we all know. Another issue for a weakness is, of course, is the high unaccounted for water. And since 2013, this unaccounted for water rate has been increasing. Of course, we did our due diligence, we did leak detection, we looked anywhere and everywhere that we could. We tried to find illicit connections, we tried to do everything, but right now it's very hard to come up with a definite answer of where all this water goes. It could be in the way that we read the meters compared to what is billed. If there's a 12-month cycle, or if it's 11 months or 10 months, it could be in the numbers. We're not sure. We're going to be asking for outside help, and I believe the state, of course, is going to recommend that we do that, you know, get a water audit done to make sure that it's done correctly. As we know, the staffing, which when this was done, has changed, of course. And we just hired two new employees, which I feel are going to be a benefit to the town once we get them up and running to speed of what needs to be done and how to do it. It's going to take some time. We have to keep the company there that we have there for a while. But I think in the long run, Hadley made a good decision to do that. This way here, you have people that can do all three jobs, can be outside, can be inside, can do the paperwork, can do the computer work, and can fix the water break if they're trained correctly, which I'm going to make sure that they are. And I'm going to be probably doing some of the training, especially the water breaks, because that's, you know, sometimes very difficult to decide what to do with a water break. And as you know, another weakness is, which I mentioned, is going to take some time for the staff to get up to speed. A T2 and a D2 is what we need. The people that we hired are good people, but their licenses are operators in training. It's going to take them 2 years to get full, you know, to be a full operator, let's say. So another issue, of course, is the incomplete records, which we have. A lot of the services over the years don't have tie cards. When I first started here, nobody took tie cards. Nobody took measurements to anything. Very limited mapping, very limited as-built plans for anything here. So as time progressed, the planning board, of course, took over and said, you know, we want as-built plans as part of, you know, your requirement to get this work done, which has been a big help. But there's a lot of catch-up work on that. I mean, I have a lot of maps. I have some even at the senior center. I mean, that has to be updated. There's, you can't, like with the other departments, say, you know, the paper trail is just way too much. So the employees, let's say the seasoned employees, kind of know off the back of their hand where the water main is or where the valves are to shut it off. The newer generation that's coming in, of course, will not know that. That's why we have to do something with that, to get these maps either on GIS or somehow, so that we can at least get to know where everything is to get everybody activated in case there's a major emergency. And of course, back to the use of the wells, well, water number two, of course, we do not use. Perchlorate was the issue that started a few years ago. We have not done anything to alleviate that problem. So it's going to require treatment. And of course, in the future, you know, that treatment is going to get more expensive. Right now, they're narrowing down what contaminants they're looking for. Iron and manganese. And manganese now is going to be a contaminant. Before it was a secondary contaminant. Now it's going to be one that's going to have to be tested for. And the opportunities, of course, are the loans, which is a big thing which we applied for. David can attest for that, that we applied for one for this Route 9 section, which will help a lot to get us farther down the road to be able to do more water mains in the future, because you know, for the town to incur $1 million for each time we do something, it's going to add up pretty fast. It's going to be too much for the water revenues to handle. And opportunity, of course, is if we don't have the equipment to do the water breaks, as you know, and the board probably saw outside contractors working on Route 9 doing work for us with the repairs, because the equipment that they have is a lot larger and can do it a lot quicker than we have. And of course, I mentioned about the outside help with the water treatment plant and having small water systems there. So I went through that. We have a 24/7 service right now that helps us out if we have any emergency. So everything should be up and running at all times. And classes, let's say, outside help with the distribution, which I mentioned earlier. They have a Mass Rural Water Association that runs training classes, everything from water mains to water meters to anything associated with water. They will come out. Actually, they did. They helped us locate some water leaks to help us out, because some of these are very difficult to locate. It's asbestos pipe. It's very hard to trace. You can't trace it. Cast iron you can, but that you can't. And of course, the threats always with the drinking water requirements. Are we going to be able to pass the test, as they say, for the drinking water? Are we always going to be, let's say, coliform free? Are we always going to be below the limits set by the state for certain contaminants? So far, of course, this year, last year, we had a few problems with the coliform. This year, knock on wood, we have not. And the state is always coming up with new drinking water requirements and what, you know, the towns will have to test for, which of course costs more money. And limitations on the water withdrawal permit. It's a permit that the state gives the towns for how much water they can pump per day out of their wells. If you exceed that, then you have to do, let's say, mitigation. You have to come up with, let's say, a water audit, a way of saving the water that you know you're allotted to use. So that was going to be an impact, because we have very high unaccounted for water. And of course, another threat which I mentioned is the old water mains. And over 60% of the mains in town are the asbestos cement line pipe. Not the oldest, but there's 60% of them, which of course are very, very expensive to dispose of. Once you have a water break, you have to get rid of them in a certain manner. You just can't throw them into the trash. It has to be through a licensed asbestos person remover that does that, and that we have to pay to get rid of it. And I'm gonna try to make this as quick as I can here. This, the wastewater division, of course, strengths, again, knowledgeable staff, persons that have been there, fully licensed staff. They maintain their licenses. They go to classes. They know all the procedures. They know the regulations. They know what's required of that system. Chief Operator Dennis Pachinski has worked here since 1974. Very knowledgeable, knows what to do, knows the problems, knows how to correct them. John Washkevitz has worked since 2001. He has worked before that for the town as a town mechanic. Again, like Dennis, very knowledgeable, knows what to do, does the hands-on stuff, let's say, and has very, very good knowledge of the system and what needs to be done. I'm not trying to say anything, John, one way or the other, but he's the wastewater mechanic, replacing the pumps and valves and pipings, and he does the annual grease trap inspections. And of course, we have Isaac Golding with 5 years experience. We have the administrative assistant, Mike Pecanot. He's been a valuable asset since 2007. And of course, prior to that, as we all know, he worked on the finance committee, so that he knows the budgets, he knows the funding, he knows what to do with certain things, whether or not we're able to do these within the limits of the money that we have to spend. And of course, he's also coordinating the impact fee. Another strength, of course, is that everyone lives close to the job, let's say, as well as I do. We live right in town, very close, and you know, if there's any emergencies, we're right there within 5 minutes. And of course, we had some plant updates, as the board knows. Pump station one, pump station four were upgraded 2015, and they're going to be more efficient, and there's going to be cost savings. We also actually have a payment. Well, that's for the sewer line on Warren, I'm sorry. And hopefully these will last for the next 50 years. A program for replacing, upgrading aging pumps at the other remaining stations will have to be looked at. Technical assistance, tie and bond. We use them a lot, engineering firm. We have actually used them on the water department and on highway stuff also. They prepared capital improvements, which they have done, and the estimated cost along with it. Aerators. During the last 5 years, all four aerators have been installed and use less electricity. Weaknesses, of course, the same as with any department, is old aging equipment. Sewer lines, some of the pump stations, some of the equipment, pickup, factor truck, is going to be needed to be replaced because of just the age of it and the use of it. Again, another weakness is the unfunded mandates, the same as the water. The NEPA's permit requirement, which is due next June of 2016. We are working on that. We have an engineering firm doing that. Unpredictable costs can occur in any department. When you are doing something and you have something that needs to be fixed, you have to do it. An example, as I wrote, was Loretta Lane. It had to be done. You had to spend the money. So that is one of the weaknesses. And of course, as I mentioned in the other divisions, the rising costs, inflation for materials and even for union contracts. Another weakness, which is mentioned in the wastewater more than the other divisions, because there are only three people in the wastewater, is the job stress and the working hours and, you know, meeting the permit requirements and be able to work the weekends, the holidays, and make sure that there's two people. So, you know, the other divisions have more individuals where they can, let's say, rotate more. And opportunities. Of course, we have the impact fee. Has generated over $700,000. And it's been offset. It's been used to offset capital costs. Current balance in that is around $235,000. And it can be supplemented from new expenditure. Example is clarifiers. Again, SRF, low interest loan, same thing as with the water, could be used to improve the system. Grants, if we could get it. And the biggest thing, of course, is with any division is the threats. And the threats, of course, would be the failures, the sewer backups, the plugs, the backups at people's houses. That is always unpredictable and, of course, can be very expensive. And, of course, the rising of the rates. The potential lack of rate increase, despite that fact that hasn't risen since 2008 and has not kept up with inflation and the cost of living, and it's just compounding itself where we eventually, again, have to do the water rates, we have to increase them, and the sewer rates will follow through. So basically, that's what I have to offer. I have a organizational chart that I'll pass off to the board.
Any questions?
I'm kind of depressed.
Well, it works as TV.
Is a lot of areas to cover.
Thank you.
So I have just one question or one kind of comment. So as we go through the water audit,
yep.
Is Sharon going to look at actually trying to track the water usage a little more by billing class?
Yep, we're trying to do that. We're going to be working with Collective. We mentioned that already with Sue to figure out the classes, as you say, and what can be done to make sure that what we pump and what we bill are in the same time period, let's say. I mean, before it took us a couple months to read the meters, we would run into January to be reading the meters, which is another year already. So that skewed, let's say, what was pumped, what was billed, what was metered to, you know, unaccounted for water. So we're working with that. I'm working with a private individual to get his input on what we need to do to improve, find out where this unaccounted for water all of a sudden started cropping up since 2013. Usually the meters, when they're old, which we've been replacing, you know, they would run slow. The newer meters, you know, should keep up to what is actually used, but the newer way of reading the meters is that the last two digits aren't read, let's say, with this new system. I don't know if that adds up to a lot of water or just a minuscule amount of water, so that will take some finding out.
Okay.
I think you were asking, can we track our water usage by customer differently than we are now? And I'm not sure I know the answer to that off the top of my head, but that's the information that you need in order to make the decision about the rates.
That's the easiest way to make a rate decision. If you want to be more broad about it, you can do it with what we have. But for us to set the rates, I think we really truly need to have a breakdown by our billing classification so we can actually see
what is commercial, what is the residential.
Yes.
Yeah.
We have different rates for those.
Yeah.
And then, all right. Anything else for DPW?
Just a question. So all of the there are a lot of capital mm-hmm. items in here. I'm assuming all of those are finding their way into the capital planning
yep.
process.
Yes, they are.
Okay, good.
Okay. So for everyone keeping track at home of what we're doing, we've just finished the tri-board meeting, kind of, with